places it could have crashed a kindergarten. Had it in the middle of the building, and in the playground there were body bags.
We'll also speak to a member of parliament who knew him and worked with the minister. We'll be in Kabul to hear about the senior UN delegation in the country trying to get the Taliban to reverse its ban on women working for humanitarian organizations. Also, the unique way that Finland punches above its weight on the world stage.
They want a special experience and they want to be part of that club. And when you go to a reception and you meet other people and you can say, oh, I didn't recognize you with your clothes on.
What is that special experience? And millionaires who want to give away their money. First, the latest world news.
Hello, this is Julie Candler with the BBC News. The head of the Ukrainian police force has been appointed acting interior minister following the death of his predecessor in a helicopter crash. Ihor Klimenko will retain his role as police chief. The crash that killed Denise Monastirsky happened on Wednesday in Provory, a suburb of Kyiv. Children whose nursery was hit are among the casualties. James Waterhouse reports from the scene.
This was the type of journey interior minister Denise Monastirsky made regularly. You'd often see him at scenes of fighting or devastation across Ukraine, and he'd often travel by helicopter. This was a journey, though, which went tragically wrong. You can see how the helicopter came down onto a nursery in the town of Brovary. At a time, children were inside. Now, there are body bags in the playground while rescue teams try to recover some of the wreckage. An investigation has started. So far, the cause is not clear. In times of war, many will suspect or blame the enemy. But helicopters often fly at low altitude to avoid being targeted. That comes with its own risks. Nevertheless, this is a loss which cuts to the heart of the Kyiv government.
The US Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen says her talks with her Chinese counterpart were candid, substantive, and constructive. This report from Celia Hatton.
Statements from both the U.S. and Chinese sides marked a positive end to the first face-to-face meeting between the two people responsible for the world's largest economies. The Chinese Vice Premier, Liu He, said he and the U.S. Treasury Secretary, Janet Yellen, had agreed to further talks following their meeting in the Swiss city of Zurich. Both the U.S. and China have tried to take steps to disentangle their economies in recent years, with mixed results. Tightening U.S. tech sanctions are forcing Silicon Valley companies to take a careful look at their businesses in China, while China continues to push policies encouraging more homegrown research and innovation.
The Iranian judiciary says that a man who beheaded his 17-year-old wife has been sentenced to 7.5 years in prison. Here's Sebastian Usher.
Images of Sajjad Haidari smiling as he held the severed head of his wife, Mona, in the streets of the city of Ahvaz caused grief and outrage in Iran last year. The brutal killing of Mona Haidari by the cousin she was married off to at the age of 12 reignited debate over male domestic violence against women, as well as demands to raise the minimum age of marriage for girls, which is set at 13 years old in Iran. The spokesman for the Iranian judiciary explained the apparent leniency Sajjad Haidari's sentence by saying that it was in line with the country's legal system after the parents of Mona Haidari pardoned him rather than demanding retribution.
World News from the BBC.
With Michigan Radio News, I'm Dick Trevino. The U.S. Supreme Court is set to hear a case that could make it more difficult for students with disabilities to resolve problems quickly when they're not getting needed assistance schools. The question for the justices today involves a deaf student from Michigan and a federal law called the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. The law guarantees disabled students an education specific to their needs. Following local election administration and banning harassment of election workers and lying to voters about their rights and petitions, those are all legislative priorities the Michigan Secretary of State outlined yesterday at a news conference. Secretary Jocelyn Benson says she and other election workers have faced a variety of protests over the past few election cycles. Benson says demonstrations outside election workers' homes are among the most troubling.
We recognize the importance of free speech, the importance of ensuring people have an ability to communicate to their election officials and provide that avenue, but also there does cross the line when it creates a hostile environment and a threatening environment, particularly in our homes.
Democrats are describing the proposed proposals as a vision setting that will help them craft future bills. They will have to contend with free speech concerns when trying to regulate providing misinformation to voters. The city of Kalamazoo is taking another step toward converting its one-way streets back into two ways. The city commission approved an agreement with an engineering firm that will help Kalamazoo plan and manage the conversion. That's according to a report from Enron. The two-way street plan is part of a bigger project to make Kalamazoo's road network more safe and accessible. The Federal Highway Safety Administration says drivers tend to go faster on one-way streets. In Michigan radio weather today, mostly cloudy skies. It'll be breezy at times, highs in the upper 30s and low 40s. This is Michigan radio.
Hello, I'm Razia Iqbal. Welcome to News Hour from the BBC World Service. It comes to you live from our studios in central London. In a moment, a helicopter crash in Kyiv kills several senior members of the government. We'll speak to our correspondent on the scene. Also, senior UN officials visit Kabul to speak to the Taliban about allowing women to work for foreign aid agencies. Japan wants to release more than a million tons of wastewater from the next Fukushima nuclear plant into the Pacific Ocean. Block the move, but say it's not up to them to come up with an alternative. Do stay with us, lots coming up this hour. We begin though with what's being described as a terrible tragedy by a man who has seen a lot of it since Russia invaded his country. Ukraine's President Volodymyr Zelensky has been commenting on the loss of three main figures in his interior ministry in a helicopter crash beside a kindergarten in an eastern suburb of the capital, Kyiv. The pain, he said, was unspeakable. The crash killed the Interior Minister, Denis Monastirsky, his first deputy, and the State Secretary. 14 others were also killed, including four children, when the helicopter came down in Brovary around 0630 GMT. There is no indication that the crash was anything other than an accident. These women described the moment the incident happened.
We heard an explosion and we just ran out. My daughter ran to get one of her. She was in a nursery. We took her. Everything was on fire over there. The cars near the building at number 19 were on fire. That's what we know at the moment. Yes, we heard it.
We not only heard it, we saw it. We in the apartment on the first floor heard the hum and then a sudden explosion. Then fire and flame.
BBC's James Waterhouse is in Kyiv and has been to the site of the crash.
It was very clear how this journey went tragically wrong. We were in a square residential estate. And interesting, there were no downed pylons or anything like that. It seems the body of the helicopter had it squared in. One of the worst places could have crashed a kindergarten. And in the middle of the building, the fire had been put out. We saw rescue crews trying to lift parts of the wreckage out. And in the playground, there were body bags beyond kindergarten. There were rotors from the helicopter which had collided with a block of flats. And there were bodies in the grass there on the floor of the playground. It was yet another picture of devastation for Ukraine against a backdrop of a continued brutal and attritional war.
There's nothing at the moment that suggests this was anything other than an accident. The weather is being cited as a possible cause for the crash.
We don't know what the cause is yet. I think we've got to stress that. The investigation has started. You're right to suggest that, you know, in times of war, the temptation is to certainly suspect or blame the enemy for hits like this. But equally, one of those who died, the Interior Minister, Denis Monastirsky, he makes trips like this all the time. They were on their way east of the Kharkiv region, close to the front line. And to get there, helicopters across the country fly at very low altitude. We're talking tree level to avoid being detected by the enemy. We've taken similar trips with ministers. It involves hugging either tree lines, and occasionally the helicopter has to vault over electricity pylons, and that comes with its own risks. It was also misty this morning, so the answers will come, and until then we won't really have a clear idea as to what brought this helicopter down, but that this happened in the central Kiev region somewhere, where there hasn't been fighting since April, but we'll have to wait and see.
James, any loss of life is devastating. And for President Zelensky, the loss of senior people in the Interior Ministry particularly difficult.
It's extremely difficult, and this is a loss which cuts right to the heart of the Kyiv administration. The entire leadership of the Interior Ministry has been wiped out. And this is a department primarily responsible for the country's police force, which has been central to the country's efforts of rebuilding whole communities, whole towns in newly liberated areas, for example.
James Waterhouse, I've also been speaking to the philosopher and journalist Vladimir Yermolenko, who lives in Brovary. His wife was doing a school run with two of his young daughters this morning when the attack happened.
I'm living across the road, like 300, maybe 400 meters away from the place, and the kindergarten where my kids are going is 200 meters away from this kindergarten. The problem is that this kindergarten is in the highly built area, so there are residential houses around it, big residential houses, 10 floor houses, 16 floor houses. The place is encircled by the police, and there are lots of fire trucks, so you can't really enter to the place unless you're part of the investigation or rescue.
There is some suggestion that there was very bad weather, which might have caused the crash. What has the weather been like?
It's strong. In the morning, there was a big fog, and perhaps the fog had actually is that there was no electricity in the city, therefore no lights in the buildings, no lights on the top of the buildings for airplanes, helicopters. So this is also insulting.
I can hear your children in the background. How would you describe what life is like for you and your family in Kyiv at the moment?
Well, this is a life in which we try to maintain normality, despite the fact that we are almost every week under missile attacks. And sometimes we hear big explosions, and sometimes we don't. I have three children, three daughters. The younger daughter is 14-year-old. She understands everything, she is totally in the news. But the younger kids are 6 and 4, so they're living their children's life. Also for them, the war is present, but kind of a background. They understand the Russia tactically, but they're trying to live their life. So they go into underground, to the garden when there is air raid siren. We might have black electricity for 7-8 hours in a row. That means no heating, no connection, no internet, no lights. But of course, we try not to get crazy, so we're trying to maintain this normality.
And when you try and talk to your children about what is happening in their world now and how much that world has changed, do you feel that as a family, you understand, everybody understands that this, however long this takes, that there will be an outcome that will be good for Ukraine?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, everybody believes in Ukraine's victory. And this is a war not of Ukraine only. This is a war of all the free world against the big tyrannical power that tries to undo every achievements of civilization, achievements of democracy. So if we don't have this belief, this resilience, this determined decisiveness, then it will be absolutely different. But we do have it, and everybody has it in Ukraine, I think, the majority of people. And every such strife, despite the huge pain, enormous pain that we have, also adds on to our feeling of resilience and our feeling of decisiveness. Therefore, everybody is doing something for the army. For example, we are going to the East tomorrow with my wife and with some other friends to bring some important things to our soldiers, to help the wounded withstand, because they are on the front line, and civilians close to the front line are in much more difficult situation than we are here in central Ukraine.
That was philosopher and journalist Vladimir Yermolenko, who lives in the area where the crash happened. Just a few moments ago, we got through to the Ukrainian Member of Parliament, Maria Messensteva. She is currently in Davos at the World Economic Forum. She's worked with all those in the Interior Minister who died in the crash.
this morning brought us yet another terrible news about a friend, about a colleague, about a professional person, but not only one. There were many on this special helicopter flight over. It was our former colleague in the parliament, Minister for Interior Monastirsky, his deputy, the secretary of his assistant, Tatiana, whom I knew also in person, three children, and other representatives of emergency services. I'm feeling devastated. I'm feeling like I've lost a part of me, because with Denis, this is how I call the minister usually, we passed many European integration laws, reforms which dealt with national police services and not only. We have signed a special historical agreement the Ukraine entered Pompidou Group just a year and a half ago when he became a minister to tackle the issue of drug. We've just lost enormous leaders of opinions, and then those people who were next to President Zelensky since day one of this brutal invasion of Russia, but even before, during his campaign to become a president. So it's almost like a family loss for us. I keep on taking some time to think over that any day, any moment, your life can be abrupted.
We are very grateful to you for agreeing to speak to us. When you speak about the Interior Minister, you refer to him by his first name. He was very young, 42, somebody who clearly had a lot more public service in him.
Yes, absolutely. He was always energetic, very positive. He was vegan. He was doing a lot of sports. He was answering. There's requests from people or colleagues or from the team. It was a 24/7 availability mode. It was just, you know, a person always ready to do the service on the ground, traveling different regions. He's been to my home region, Kharkiv. So Denis will always be in our hearts and in our thoughts. And we just pray that the souls of those who lost their lives today, including children, will find peace. And those who might be responsible for that will be held accountable.
There is nothing, though, that currently suggests this was anything other than an accident, a terrible tragedy.
There are three versions, including interference, possible interference, but nothing concrete, and emergency services, including the Interior Ministry, say that it might take hours or even days to confirm what has really happened, even though those who are living in the small town next to Kyiv have seen that the helicopter was already burning while being towards the ground on its way before the crash. So we are not in charge of discussing the details as of now, but emotionally and as a human being, all the colleagues who are now present in Ukraine, in Davos at the Economic Forum, we were literally crying when we saw it. I always hope that this is fake news, but unfortunately it's not.
That was Ukrainian MP Maria